Welcome to Brick World Chicago, the largest migration of aphids in the Western Hemisphere.
You ready, Luna?
Thanks, Matt. Mm-hmm.
Let's get inside and get bricked. Brick World Chicago, let's go. Says it all. Woo! All right, I'm here with David Hall. He is a Lego builder extraordinaire. He is known for his Lego Star Wars mocks. And today he's gonna tell us a little bit about his latest creation, Dave.
Yeah, so this is actually part of a bigger collaboration. This whole collaboration is based off the Lego Star Wars 2, the original trilogy video game, which came out in like the mid 2000s, I want to say. So this is a scene from the video game, and it's also a scene from Star Wars Episode 6. So this is the indoor landing pad scene. We have indoor Luke and indoor Leia right here. They actually need to turn these switches off, which turn off these generators, so you'll notice one doesn't have shields on it. Once you have all those off, you're supposed to fly up into the AT-AT, and you're supposed to blow up the little generators with that. So it's all built out of Lego instead of being trapped inside a video game.
I love the little like details with the walkways down here.
Yeah, there's a lot of little details. I love doing the groundwork and all of that. It's a lot of fun. There's a reason why this is all blank right here. It's like that in the game, so I try to be as accurate as possible.
How long did this take you to put together, David?
I got it done in about a week.
Wow, dude, see that's why they pay him the big bucks. I mean, come on. Congrats, man.
I appreciate it. It helps having a lot of Lego at your disposal so you can build quicker.
David's organized. He's got everything in its own separate little boxes. How do you organize your brick?
By color and element. So like rows are one element, and then vertically, it's by color, if that makes sense. Walk down the hallway of Lego piece and find exactly what you need.
What's your next build going to be? Like, what are you cooking up? I know you got tons of ideas.
Well, I'm working on my Geonosis mock on my YouTube channel. That'll be my biggest Lego mock that I've ever made. It's 12 feet long.
Oh, wow.
It's already easily over 100,000 pieces. And then after that one's done, which hopefully will be in a couple months, then I've got an idea of what I'll build, but I can't tell you.
Little secret.
It's a secret.
Nice. Yeah. What happens when you run out of Star Wars stuff to make? Like, they've only made a certain amount of movies. Are you worried about that?
Well, I know they announced 3 more movies, and they've got like a Disney Plus show every other day, it seems like.
But those don't count.
Did you see the photo of Harrison Ford and George Lucas?
I did, yeah.
Oh,
it looks so good.
Oh my God.
Why does George always look like that in every single photo? They need to give him more time.
There was a time back in 2018 where I was just like one day away from potentially meeting him. He was in Denmark to see a Lego house museum. He was there the day before I got there. And like the Lego designer's like, "You just missed Mr. Lucas." And I'm like,
the George Lucas of Lego bricks, David Hall, everybody.
Thank you, Forrest. I appreciate it, man.
You're welcome, man.
Good seeing you, buddy.
I continue to search the convention for meaning. While many builds have their merits, there can be only one. As I mull about the convention, I look up and down the tables in search of that one build that stands out above all else. There is but one build, one mock, my own creation, that will prevail. I just have to find it. So it looks like there's going to be some sort of reveal here in a bit. There's Chris working back there. The guy knows how to put on a show. This is going to be good. I saw a brown boot.
Is this not Woody?
There's no hat. Like, the rim of the hat would be there. What do you think it is?
I think it's
course.
All right, everyone, we are moments away from revealing the largest statue we have ever built here at Bricker Builds. So excited to see you all here for the big reveal.
Let's reveal the model in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Oh, that's a good one.
Oh my God. Oh, that is awfully great.
Congrats, man.
I appreciate you guys big time.
Anytime.
This is Batman 1883. He's riding his horse. It's the Dark Knight here. Nolan's next movie, after this atomic bomb one he's doing, he's going back further in time to the medieval days. The horse's eyeballs are pretty interesting. They're a little psychedelic. They're a little creepy. You don't want to stare into them too much.
Wow. Looks like we have an amazing Indiana Jones moment happening here. And we even have... We got Steven Spielberg here directing the film. We've got the old school Indy battling his Nazi foe. Lego Indiana Jones, The Original Adventures. Gonna be out soon for Wii, Nintendo DS, and Xbox 360. Okay, we're here with Andrew, and he's gonna tell us a little bit about his amazing Dark Knight Returns sculpture here.
Based off of Frank Miller's artwork from The Dark Knight Returns, definitely one of the most influential stories for me. Besides, I've got this Swamp Thing from kind of basically based on like Alan Moore's run, also another DC character, not quite as popular as Batman, but still an important one.
I love the way you got some nice posing out of him. He's like mid-stride.
I learned a lot from this. I wish I got his arms a little more articulated, but, you know, I tried to get him some kind of little crunchy pose there.
Of course. And would you be interested in drawing from the random Lego bag?
Sure.
Okay, nice. We got one. All right, Andrew, whenever you're ready, man.
It looks a little messy.
Don't worry about that.
Okay. So I just, like, close my eyes and
stick
it in?
Yeah, close your eyes and stick your hand in there.
I just got it.
Dig deep. The best ones are at the very, very bottom. The most expensive ones are down there. He's doing it.
Oh, nice. Oh.
Yes, man. Excellent. What are you going to do with that?
I'm not sure. I actually...
Maybe you could add those to the Swamp Thing. There's some nice little leaf pieces there. We'll be right back. this is a pretty spectacular kind of once in a lifetime event here, this mega cyberpunk village. So let's make our way to the main event. This is pretty insane. I mean, you only see something like this every once, you know, in a blue moon. So take it all in and enjoy yourself. You know, one day we'll be living inside one of these things and it won't be as cool, you know, not in Lego form. But in Lego form, it's pretty sweet. If it was real life, it'd be ultimately pretty dystopian. I like these guys who built it. They all have racing style shirts. They've got logos all over their shirts. Really professional, like they're sponsored, you know? If we make our way over this way, we might get a chance to speak with one of them. See if we can talk to this guy. He looks like he's touched a few bricks in his day. See all the logos on his shirt? It's like an MMA fighter, but with bricks.
It's cool, they all have little matching like jersey uniform thing.
I know, it's like they're MMA fighters or something. What's your name?
George.
Okay, cool. Can you tell us a little bit about this whole project and specifically what you did on it?
Yes. So this was just an idea that we'd kind of been sitting on for a while. So the original thing that this is based off of was a collab that Brolug did 10 years ago in 2013. And so we brought a bunch of those members back that were originally on that collab, to just trying to do the same theme, but kind of just go as big as we can.
One thing I'm kind of curious about is the connections and like who works on what and how you guys plan on putting it all together. How does that go down?
There was a Brolug member, Forest King, that designed this cube frame here, which is a 32 by 32 by 32, which is the standard that almost everything on here is built off of. And you can see it all throughout. Sometimes it's hidden. Aquarium in there, it's hidden around those pieces,
right,
but
you didn't really notice it.
Exactly, but that's kind of allows us to stay within a standard that makes it easier for everyone to connect together, and they're really strong too.
Yeah, they look pretty tough. Can you put your body weight on that?
I'm not going to, because these aren't my bricks and I don't want to break them.
I bet you could though.
I probably could, but I'm not going to test that.
Well, just like kind of like stand next to it, and then we'll Photoshop you on top of it. There. That looks good.
I see like these neon lights you have going everywhere. What are those? How do you do that effect?
That is a thing called EL wire. I believe there's some store on eBay that we got those from, a bunch of different colors. And there's certain power functions like you can see on this sign here that we can flicker them on and off.
Right here we have a Nickelodeon extra super cool mystery bag. We're going to get you to reach your hand in if you'd like to participate and you could win a prize.
I wonder what's on the outside.
Like giving birth to a baby cow, you got this.
Oh, wonderful.
Can we take out any kitchen packets?
Oh, you got a good one.
Cool.
No, don't help him, he's on his own.
Awesome, woo!
How saturated the guy. Like, it's kind of been brewing in there all day.
What's another wet wipe?
I guess he can have one more.
I can't.
No more after this, though.
Miranda, what did I tell you about blowing your nose? Come on.
We have a Lego Jurassic Park set number 76958.
Try not to get the slime on everything.
Very collage like, but in a very organized way. I really dig it. I like the gradients and such, kind of enhancing the weathering features and stuff like that. Is that yours?
Yeah, these are my builds.
Great. Wow, I really like the fire details you have here.
Thank you. It's not super sturdy, but it's a lot of fun to try and mess with that structure.
Which Lego line is this based on?
This is the Ice Planet 2002 theme from the early 90s.
Right, yeah. Oh, that's so great. Yeah, I love the classic vibe about it. Yeah, I love seeing like the themes expanded upon in the bigger scales that we never get to see them in. It's really awesome. Wow. So right here we have Disneyland-inspired builds. I really enjoy this. We have the monorails. Walt actually thought that monorails would be like the transportation of the future. Boy, was he wrong.
So this is lamellar armor. It was used in medieval times and Vikings. It was also used in Japan. And then I'm also working on a chainmail project. I don't have enough parts for it, but here's the sample fabric, if you will. If anybody had more than 75 on BrickLink, I've already bought them.
what are you doing?
I actually really like this build here. It really demonstrates that size doesn't matter. You have that big city over there. It's so overwhelming to look at. There's just so much going on. But it's all you need is just something little, you know? Like, I can, like, really take this all in. It's like, you got a nice stadium. We got the Land of Oz. Like, it's just got everything.
All right, Wizard of Oz, Spinneroo. It's kind of a Twister-inspired Wizard of Oz mock. You can see it goes round and round and round, and the creativity never ends. You got the Yellow Brick Road, obviously, wrapping all around. You got the flying monkeys attacking our heroes with the Witch's Castle in the far background. And then we got the finale of the film with the hot air balloon and Dorothy wishing that she was back home. So then they got the black and white grayscale Kansas. This is fantastic.
Step forward!
Let's go.
Come on.
I'm here with Josiah, and he's going to tell us a little bit about his build.
Okay, so this is a collaboration between us five. We're siblings, and we decided we would want to do a book that was written a long time ago. It was really popular in England for a time, Pilgrim's Progress. I'm sure a lot of people have heard about it, but not too many read it these days. So we told the story, beginning where he's in the City of Destruction, and he has a book, and he finds the book, and that represents the Bible. So he found the Bible, he started reading it, and he felt the burden of sin on his back. So we built the burden, the City of Destruction, and then he moved on, and he tried to escape the City of Destruction because he knew he was going to get destroyed. So he came to the swamp, and that's where he felt some despair, despond, because he had a burden on and he was sinking. The burden of sin was going to drown him. But then he comes to the door, and it says, knock and it shall be opened. And he gets into the path of life and finds the cross. And that's where his burden falls off, because that's the burden of sin. But Christ paid for that burden on the cross.
Nice.
So instead of him having the burden, it falls off. Well, I didn't write the story. I'm just telling you that we built the story.
Right, of course.
Even though the burden fell off, he comes across a bunch of people he has to fight. He has to get the armor of God on, so that's kind of a representation of the Word of God and the Sword of the Spirit. And then he comes across Vanity Fair. And in Vanity Fair, he encounters all kinds of trifles and things that are to distract him. But since he doesn't like that, they put him in a cage up there. So then he has to endure that until they let him out, although they kill his friend in that city.
Damn, R.I.P.
Yeah, and then you get to this Castle Despair, where a giant of despair comes at him, because, you know, sometimes people just start to despair.
I like how you did the muscles on the giant there.
That was my brother, he did the muscles. So, and then he goes and he escapes from the Castle Despair with God's help, and he gets to Delectable Valley, the valleys where they have a very pleasant time, and God helps him to get to the Celestial City. So through Christ, he can go into the gate, and that is the end of his life, but he has life eternal after that.
Excellent, man. Really impressive work. I love how you detailed the story for us. I love the way you did, like, the little path, like, pieces along, you know, the sheep, like, with the fluffiness.
My little sister helped with that. There's eight of us total, so some of them helped with a little of the details.
Oh, man, that's sick. How long did this take to put together?
Altogether, probably about 2 months, so five of us working on it.
Wow!
2 months. Yeah.
That's speedy.
It is pretty speedy. I would have liked to have had more time, more bricks, but, you know, you got to do what you have.
No, I think you pulled it off. I mean, this is definitely exceptional, and it tells kind of a darker, you know, scarier side of Christ that I think, you know, some of us might need to shake us from our apathy.
Yeah, I hope it does that.
This might be my favorite exhibit so far this year. I mean, it's so metal. Everybody's a skeleton. Everybody's dead. I love that. I believe this is based on the Day of the Dead, which is a Mexican holiday, if I'm not mistaken. Or maybe it was a Spanish holiday before Mexicans were a thing. I don't know. Okay, so it seems they've set up some sort of tents in the middle of the fair, and we have no idea what's inside, but we're gonna find out. This is gonna be sick, dude. Oh man, there's like, I think there's some fish on the outside. So I'm imagining it's gonna be some sort of like black light experience, you know, with an aquatic nature.
Aquatic life like this sometimes glows under black light. So black light pass in animation, that'd be pretty slick, I think, you know? Yeah, yeah. A lot of green stuff, a lot of plant life, a lot of fish, seahorse, and yeah, but it's quite romantic in here, actually.
I don't know where he finds the energy, the imagination, the craftsmanship, but he's got it in spades. And he's even got kind of an interior, you know, section back here, or a royal courtyard. Looks like everyone's having a good time. Looks like he might be the chosen one. He might be worthy. Brick Snap's over there. He participated in like a 5K run for cancer or something. I saw him on Instagram and I was like, damn. There goes a brickhead. He's right behind me, but he's too cool. He's not gonna do it. He's not gonna. You don't want to do another interview, right?
I'm happy to. I don't mind. Yeah.
You're busy. I don't want to. You're doing your own thing.
I'm good. Whatever you want to do.
I need a countdown from five from everybody here at the Bricker Builds booth. Let's reveal the model in 5, 4, 3, 2, 1.
Wow, it's a little boy. The tip of the shaft is usually the most sensitive.
Yeah, it keeps falling off there.
We are here with Ant Bandit, finally, in the flesh. And he's gonna show us his new build.
Yep, welcome to Brick World. Okay, so here we've got this jellyfish sculpture, which I'm really proud of. 99% translucent blue bricks.
I saw this on your Instagram, you were doing like a little sneak peek.
Yeah. Little teaser.
Everyone was curious, they were wondering like, what's this guy building, what's he up to?
They're asking the questions and I'm here to deliver.
I like how it jiggles a little bit.
Yeah, get it going. You can jiggle a little bit, you know? So, yeah.
Now you've started something.
Yeah, now I've started. Yeah. Usually you're not allowed to touch people's stuff. Yeah. These transparent pieces here,
the tubing.
Yeah. They're expensive and they're hard to come by. I had to buy a bunch from Thailand, but the rest is, the rest is pretty easy, so.
How much are we talking? I mean, don't be bashful.
Oh, I mean, fairly expensive. I can't remember off the top of my head, but I think the most expensive part was there's a big transparent plate in the center of that, it's like a $20 plate.
Like Technic pieces holding them up?
Yeah, it's like Technic beams. Wow. Yep, and then the turntable for movement, because we need a little bit of movement.
Would you be willing to trade this new exclusive LEGO Pokemon set? What? It's not out yet, these are coming out next year. I will trade it to you for that set, how about?
For this set?
Yeah.
Yes.
Got this one too, check it out.
Ooh.
Yeah, pretty fancy, huh? All right, I'm here with Josh, and he's gonna tell us a little bit about his oceanic build.
Yeah, the inspiration for this really came from, I've loved seeing mocks that are made of beach scenes and above the water, and I love seeing things below the water, but I'd never seen anybody try to integrate the two at the same time. And ever since then, I've just been trying to make the water look as authentic as possible, get away from the straight lines that too often is in Lego, and try and have as much movement and fluidity to it.
Nice. Yeah, I love the concept, and you've really like captured the ocean floor very well. I think James Cameron would be very proud.
That's true. You know, we're going to go dive deep for the Titanic. They have the fun volcano right there at the end. So, yeah, it was just neat to see what could do and think about some of the fun things that you would, you know, see underwater.
Very cool. Well, I've got a little surprise for you.
Okay.
Yeah. This is, hasn't come out yet. This is the brand new Lego set.
Wow.
I think it's coming out next year, but I got an inside scoop. So I want you to have that.
Authentic. Thank you. Yeah. I think Squirtle and all will be perfect in the beach, right?
Definitely. Yeah, that's official Lego. So,
perfect.
You know, treat
like
it well.
See, it says right there.
Okay, Brick World's slowing down a bit. You know, like the foot traffic has decreased somewhat. So I'm able to get around and kind of discuss some sets here. Looks like we've got kind of an alien world. And amongst the terrain, you'll notice a menagerie of orange Lego pieces representing the alien liquid goo. Could be lava, could be a vital life source for these inhabitants. But something's happening. They're either extracting something or they're putting energy down into the planet. We really don't know. It's a lot of this set is left up to a mystery. I mean, it's very abstract in a lot of ways.
They're sucking out the core of the Earth.
Okay, Gus says he thinks that they're sucking out the core of the Earth. You know, it's very likely. Aliens are known for wanting to take resources. We've known this from sci-fi films in the past, so it's a safe assumption.
But they could also, maybe they're planting like big alien seeds, you know? Maybe they're doing something productive. We can dream.
This set's pretty cool. I was saying I really like the lava effect, how it's just like solid orange, just really striking rather than like transparent pieces. Lots of cool building techniques. I see the video, like cube canisters all over, Death Stars, all kinds of crazy stuff. And like these ships, they look incredible. Like look at the shaping on that and then the lights and everything and how they're up. It went from like UFO to being like UF whoa. Like, I don't know, it's amazing.
We got one more Lego in the random Lego trash bag. So we're gonna try to find someone else, one last target, and then we can get the hell out of here. I don't remember them being white.
I think they're gray, but I think the white kind of like pops a bit more.
Yeah, right. He's missing the entire convention. He better be into Lego when he's older.
Yeah, yeah. Honestly, crossover is my favorite part, but it's stressful. It's really hectic.
Do you want to do a pull on the Lego bag?
Is it gonna get my hand dirty?
Yeah.
No.
Okay.
Can I just look?
Yeah, you can look.
Don't touch it. Don't touch it.
You can look.
Oh God.
You know, beware.
Beware.
Yeah, there's
the slime.
Beware of the slime.
This is a bad idea. Why do you have this? Did you bring this with you?
Yeah, I brought. Yeah, I bought a bunch of slime. There's just trash in there, you know, too. I think I see one with your name
on it. Not worth it for the speed champions.
Yeah,
I don't think.
Yeah, she's making the wise decision and she's backing out.
Yeah.
Yeah. All right. So it looks like right here we've got Darth Vader in kind of a sexualized outfit. You see this a lot with these Star Wars nerds. They always have to come and make things sexy that weren't meant to be sexy initially. Kind of reminds me of this ad that I got on Instagram last night for a sexy Star Wars burlesque show here in Chicago. And I think I'm going to take all the boys. My treat. The Star Wars fans, like, they're horny. Even for Lego, they'll never stop with their endless sexualization. And that, look, they've even got another slave Leia running around. These nerds, they can't help themselves, man.
You know those ads only pop up on Instagram based on, like, your search and algorithm and, like, what they think.
That's hearsay. That's hearsay, Ben. That's a theory. So we're trying to find one last victim for our slime bag here.
Ooh.
And would you be willing to take a poll?
So what am I doing?
From the random Lego trash bag.
So I just reach in and take anything out of it?
Yeah, reach in and take anything out of it.
Okay, right. 100% game.
Let's do it, man.
Here we go.
Where do I enter?
There's only one left.
Only one.
It was full earlier.
Yes. Yellow mustard.
Wow.
Nice, man. Good job. Good poll.
Oh, thank you very much.
Yeah. What is that one?
A Pagani? Is that how you pronounce it, a Pagani?
Yeah, that's exactly
Yeah.
The Legos are all depleted, and we are going to be officially throwing out the slime bag now.
A most remarkable proposition has recently sparked my interest, an advocacy of such import as to invite gentle persons of every age into the joyous embrace of youthful pastimes. A call to play with the much-admired Lego brick, a device of such ingenious design as to have occupied the nimble fingers and fertile imaginations of children for many a generation. The sentiment in question, though perhaps unusual to some, is not to be dismissed lightly. It invites closer scrutiny, with a particular focus on the merits of engaging in this playful endeavor by the discerning adult. There is a vulgar prejudice that permeates the air of the drawing room, where the adult mind is to be occupied with the toil of work, the commerce of social engagement, or the somber contemplation of world affairs. This prevailing sentiment is nothing short of a fallacy, for who is to decree the manner in which the adult mind might find its amusement or respite from life's demanding trials? The engagement with Lego bricks, though initially conceived for the education and entertainment of children, offers a haven of merit for the grown mind and its manifold sophistications. First and foremost, let us indulge in an examination of the benefits to be reaped from an adult liaison with Lego bricks. The practice engages one's creative faculties, like a fresh breeze sweeping through the closed corridors of the mind, shaking off the dust of the mundane, the prosaic, and the overwrought. It offers a canvas of primary colors and interlocking geometries to the latent artist and architect in every one of us, encouraging us to render the insubstantial fabric of our imaginations into a tactile, three-dimensional reality. And is not such a creation a sublime joy, to hold in one's hand a physical testament to one's inner will? Furthermore, it is no secret that the adult world is riddled with complexities and hardships, often inducing a state of anxiety and stress. Lego bricks, with their simple, predictable, and tactile nature, act as a most potent salve. The act of sorting, connecting, and assembling these modular pieces can very much mirror the calming effects attributed to meditative practices. They offer a realm of control, of structure, where every piece has its place, and every structure follows the immutable laws of physics, a delightful contrast to the frequently capricious nature of life's endeavors. Then, consider the implications of the Lego brick on the cultivated mind's continuing education. The pursuit of knowledge is not merely the domain of scholars in their musty libraries, but also of the noble Eiffel, toiling away tirelessly in their musty basements. Lego bricks, with their elemental simplicity and yet infinite combinatorial possibilities, serve as an excellent primer to the fundamental principles of engineering, architecture, and design. In their modest way, they invite us to contemplate spatial relationships and aesthetic balance. On a societal note, the engagement with Lego bricks encourages camaraderie. Gathering around the table, bricks scattered like the pieces of a freshly slain lamb, individuals are invited to contribute to a collective enterprise, a potent antidote to the divisive tendencies of our age. Lastly, and perhaps most poignantly, the handling of these brightly colored bricks offers a conduit to the carefree days of youth, a precious strand of memory connecting us to the unencumbered delight of our childhood days. They invite us to shed, for a moment, the solemn countenance of adulthood, to remember that life, with all its serious pursuits, also abounds with opportunities for simple joy. In conclusion, though it may appear folly to some, the case of the Eiffel, adult fan of Lego, is a robust one. It is not merely a frivolous amusement, but a portal to creativity, tranquility, learning, camaraderie, and cherished remembrances. So let us cast aside the shackles of conventional adult decorum and embrace the delights of the Lego brick. Let it stand as a testament to the adage that there is no age limit to the pursuit of joy, the cultivation of the mind, or the desire to shape the world around us, one brick at a time.
All right, little man, now that you're awake, what do you think of the con?
Oh, sweet.
Hey. Yes.
Bye. I love you.